Peter, 1 Peter chapter 2. We're going to try and finish chapter 2 today. We'll look at what God's wanting to say to us. So let's pray, because I definitely need God's help, and I'm sure you all do too. So, Father, thank you for your goodness. Thank you that you never change. Thank you that in the ups and downs of life that we experience, you are constant. You are unchanging. You are forever faithful. You are forever good. You are forever loving. You are forever perfect, and you lack nothing. And Father, where we lack, thank you that we can look to you, our Heavenly Father, who has everything that we need, is everything that we need. And Father, we come this morning and look to you and just say we need you. As we've sang this morning, we need you more than yesterday, more than the breath. And Father, this morning I ask that you would speak to us through your word, through the words that we share, that we read, that we listen to. Father, let us not leave this place without hearing from you, without receiving from you, and without being changed by you. And I pray for your grace and your mercy and your Holy Spirit and your anointing to touch the parts of our lives that need transforming by your power. In Jesus' name, amen. So we're going to look at chapter 2, verses 18 to 25 of 1 Peter. And if we could have the New Living Translation, that would be great, and then it matches what I'm reading. Last time I spoke, we looked at submitting to human authority and respecting kings, leaders, governors, rulers, but loving our fellow believers. And generally, I think Peter was probably talking to people who maybe were Roman, because there was a kind of two-tier system, weren't there? There were Roman citizens who had way more rights than the Jewish people, but then equally there were those that weren't free, were slaves. So let's read what it says. And now Peter's addressing those people who may be owned by someone. And we might think that we're not owned by someone, but the reality is that we all have to serve somebody in this world. And so it's helpful sometimes for us to think of ourselves as people who are subject to authorities and masters. So verse 18, it says, "You who are slaves must accept the authority of your masters with all respect. Do what they tell you, not only if they are kind and reasonable, but even if they are cruel. For God is pleased with you when you do what you know is right and patiently endure unfair treatment. Of course, you get no credit for being patient if you are beaten for doing wrong. But if you suffer for doing good and endure it patiently, God is pleased with you. For God called you to do good, even if it means suffering, just as Christ suffered for you." He is your example. He is our example. And you must follow, we must follow in his steps. Verse 22, "He never sinned, nor ever deceived anyone. He did not retaliate when he was insulted, nor threaten revenge when he suffered. He left his case in the hands of God, who always judges fairly. He personally carried our sins in his body on the cross so that we can be dead to sin and live for what is right. By his wounds you are healed. Once you were like sheep who wandered away, but now you have turned to your shepherd, the guardian of your souls." So a bit of historical context. So obviously the Roman Empire was, you know, ruling at the time and in charge, and human trafficking, the slave trade, was very much alive, and the Roman Empire would acquire slaves through warfare. You know, if they'd win a war, people were obviously taken as prisoners, sold as slaves, often domestic services, you know, cooking, cleaning, doing whatever, you know, the kind of those jobs that the Roman citizens would prefer someone else to do. But then equally, often Greek prisoners, Greek kind of spoils of war, people who were highly educated would often be taken as slaves. And it wouldn't be unheard of, and there were slaves who may be even, you know, really well educated, accountants, physicians, you know, there would be doctors that were slaves that weren't free people. And if you were a slave, you could be exploited, you could be subjected to corporal punishment, whereas Roman citizens weren't. You could be tortured, you could be executed. It was very much a two-tier system. Occasionally there would be uprisings. We've probably all heard of Spartacus, who was a Greek kind of military leader who led kind of uprising against the Roman Empire. And so that's the kind of historical context. And here Peter is talking to Christians, addressing Christians who are slaves. Now, lots of people who don't really know the Bible think that it is pro-slavery. And, you know, when I was a teacher, pupils in my class would often say, "Sir, the Bible is pro-slavery." And, you know, on reflection, I'm kind of thinking, how on earth do you come to that conclusion that the Bible is pro-slavery when, you know, God, one of the biggest, possibly even the biggest, freeing of slaves is God's doing, is documented in Exodus, where, you know, Israelites are treated so harshly, and God's desperate to free them. He gives them the Ten Commandments so that they won't have the slavery mindset of just being made to work and work and work. And he gives them the Sabbath. He gives them his law to try and help them to live as free people that love him. And we're the same, aren't we? God gives us our freedom. And, you know, as we studied in Judges, God's people often, when they're given the freedom, when God comes through for them, sets them free, we return to slavery in different forms. And it's the same today, isn't it? The world considers itself free, but in reality, this world is slave to all sorts of things. And it's actually only Jesus who can give us true freedom. That's why it says in God's word, "Who the Son sets free is free indeed." True freedom is only found in Jesus. And so we should take the words in this book seriously, and really kind of pay attention. I just want to read, just to kind of help, kind of, obviously the Bible kind of cross-references. I was listening and studying something the other day about how actually the Bible is kind of the most hyperlinked book in the world. You know, if the Bible was a web page, there'd be links between everything, wouldn't there? And if we go to 1 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 21, we see, obviously we've just read Peter's instructions. These are the Apostle Paul's instructions. And this is what he says. And so it's helpful to have this in mind when we're looking at it. It says, "Are you a slave? Don't let that worry you. But if you get a chance to be free, take it." Now, keep it there. So basically, Paul's saying, are you not a free person? Are you subject to someone else? Are you owned by someone else? He says, starts off by saying, actually, that's not the most important thing. That's not the number one thing that you should be worried about. He doesn't say it's not important. He doesn't say that it's right. He's not condoning slavery, because he even says, if you get a chance to be free, take it. He would prefer you to be free. But he says, don't let that worry you. So what does he go on to say? If we can go to the next verse, Victor. says, and remember, if you were a slave when the Lord called you, so before you knew Jesus, were you a slave? You are now free in the Lord. As I said, in Exodus, God's desperately trying to set people free from the slavery mentality, the slavery mindset. And so Paul is speaking to people who were slaves, are slaves, and saying, get this into your head, get this into your heart. You may be a slave in this world, but you are free in the Lord. God has set you free. You might still have to serve a master, an earthly master, but you are free in the Lord. And then he says to the people who were free, if you were free when the Lord called you, you are now a slave of Christ. Because for those people that maybe, you know, have their completely independent, not owned by anyone, don't have to work for anyone, don't have to submit to anyone in the same way as a slave did in those days, then we can start to think, oh, we don't have to listen to anybody. We can do what we like. And we can have that same mentality with God. And that's not right either. And so he says, if you are free, you are a slave of Christ. And what that means is, we live for God. We don't live to please ourselves. We live to please Christ. And actually that is, as I've said, when we are set free by Jesus, bought by him. You know, the Bible says that you are not your own, you are bought with a price. So the question is not, are we free or are we a slave? It's who we are a slave to. And actually, when we are a slave to Christ, he gives us those desires and brings those blessings, and it is the best place to be, because that is ultimately our original design. We were designed to be, well, we were created by God, made in his image to live for him, to live for his glory. And so, you know, being a slave of Christ is not a negative thing. It's the best thing we could possibly be. And so he's kind of addressing both sets of people, those who are slaves, those who are free, and saying this is how to think. So, next verse. Here we go. God paid a high price for you by his own blood. So don't be enslaved by the world. And that is the danger. When we are free, and as we read last time, it says, don't use your freedom as a cover-up for sin. So, and this is what the temptation is, that when we're free to do what we like, when we're not bound by an earthly master, then we can start to do things that are enslave us. If you carry on, Victor. Each of you, dear brothers and sisters, should remain as you were when God first called you. So, becoming a Christian doesn't suddenly mean that we disobey our earthly masters. So, you know, you might have a job you could feel like slavery at times, couldn't it? Like, you have to be there, you get docked pay if you're late, obviously it's not the same, but you can feel like that at times, can't you? Especially, you know, in some jobs where you're not treated with respect, that you're kind of made to work really hard. But, you know, there's lots of documentaries, aren't there, about people working in warehouses and how they're not allowed to even sit down for a moment. But when we become a Christian, we're not called to just reject that. We're not say, right, I've become a Christian, boss, see you tomorrow, see you later. No. Paul's saying, actually, carry on serving your earthly masters, but do it in a way that honors God. If you keep going. Because of this present crisis, I think it is best to remain as you are. So, you know, we're not, I mean, some of us might be when we, that's it, we're moving on to marriage next, Victor, so that's all I wanted to say from 1 Corinthians, but God doesn't call every one of us, when we come to know him, to suddenly quit our job, sell everything, and go and move to a foreign country and become a missionary. Okay? When I was growing up, that was often the story that was told, and it seemed that to be a true Christian, what you had to do was just be free of everything and go and live in some place, foreign, remote land, and preach the gospel. But actually, a big part of being a Christian is remaining where you are, bearing up under suffering, living as a slave of Christ in it through that, and actually being a witness, being a salt, being salt, being light in whatever profession you are in, whether you are a doctor, whether you're a cleaner, whether you are an accountant, whether you are working in the public sector, in the private sector, in a charity, wherever you are, as long as it isn't directly in disobedience to God. You know, there are some professions that God would definitely call you out of, but ultimately, God calls us to live for him right where we are. So if we go back to 2 Peter chapter 2, let's look at this. So it says that we should follow the example of Jesus. That's you know, that is it, isn't it? Jesus set us the example. He showed us the way to live. And it says he never sinned. Some suffering. Anyone suffered? Anyone? Yeah? Anyone? Two people have suffered. Maybe the world's not as bad as I thought it was. We've all suffered, haven't we? Now, has anyone suffered because of something stupid they did? Yeah. Some suffering's just because of our, you know, self-inflicted, because of our foolishness. Especially, you know, you'd like to think as kids, we do things and we eventually start to learn, yeah, these things cause pain and suffering. These things don't. So, we're always telling Matthias off because he kind of, well, not always telling him off, but often, the way he moves around is just, he flails his arms and legs. And for those of you that know, we've got bits and bobs around the house because we're currently still converting our loft. And he'll just stub his toe on something, or he'll hurt his finger on something, and then he'll fall to the ground and just cry. And he's not really hurt, but he's just, you know, and it's like, just walk sensibly. Do you know what I mean? Walk sensibly and you won't hurt yourself. And so some suffering is self-inflicted. Other suffering sometimes is because of our sin. You know, it might be because of our foolishness. It might be because of our wickedness. But some suffering is just because we live in a fallen world and there's no direct link to it, if that makes sense. Because if suffering was because of our sin all the time, if it was always because of our sin, then, well, let's look. Verse 22, it says, he never sinned. And yet Jesus suffered, didn't he? So that suffering wasn't because of any sin. Jesus was perfect. Jesus never sinned. And yet he suffered because he entered into our fallen world where we've rebelled against God. And when we rebel against God, that's a big deal, because God is infinitely good, infinitely perfect, infinitely loving, and yet we've rebelled against him. And you know, one of the questions that lots of people ask, and you may have yourself, is if God is good, why is there suffering in the world? That's often, you know, you'll speak to people who don't know God, and the biggest question is, why does God allow suffering? You know, atheists will go, why do children suffer bone cancer, you know, that haven't committed any sort of, you know, innocent, and yet they suffer? If you look in, I mean, it doesn't take much to look around and think of all the suffering in the world. You know, the innocent people, women, children, suffering in Ukraine, obviously, the victims, the Jews during Nazi Germany, chemical warfare, the children, women, men who suffer horrendous things in this world. And some people would go, well, a lot of people would go, how can God be a loving God if they believe he exists? Or how can he even exist when there's all this horrendous, horrific suffering in the world? And I think the thing that we forget, or when we think like that, is to think how we minimize our sin, don't we? We think God is bad, we're good, and if God was really good, he would stop all this and prevent all this. But let's flip it around a little bit, and let's just think what actually happened, okay? If we go to Genesis, God created this perfect world, didn't he? perfect world where everything was good. Several times God stops and looks at what he's done and says it was good. And that's kind of understatement. In our English language, good is like, if you're in education, good is like second best, isn't it? Outstanding is the best. And so the word good doesn't do justice. Or we maybe downplay the word good in our English language. Good is just absolute perfection. When Jesus is approached by a young man and he calls him good teacher. And Jesus says, "Why do you call me good? Only God is good." He was rebuking him in a way for misusing the word good. But God made a good world, a perfect world. God being a perfect, loving Father, generous, infinitely generous, infinitely good, infinitely truthful, infinitely gracious, infinitely merciful, infinitely wonderful, creative, powerful. Words can't describe God, can they? Words can't describe how good God is. And we as humans, his image bearers, received all that, were given all of that, and we effectively stuck two fingers up to God and said, "No, we're doing things our way." And that is the biggest, that is more horrendous than the worst thing, the worst of human suffering. If you're appalled by human suffering, what we actually need to be appalled by is how humans have rebelled against God, a good God, a good, good God. And I think when we come to God, when God grants us salvation, it's where God does, his spirit does a change in our hearts, doesn't it? He kind of suddenly we're aware of how sinful we are and how good God is. But often the world goes, "God's not good. Look at all this. This is not fair." And we don't turn things around. Originally, human beings thought that that the sun revolved around us, didn't it? That was a belief at a time. It was, the sun revolves around the earth because they saw it moving, or it appeared to be moving. And that was the thinking for a long time. And then eventually, I think someone in ancient Greek figured it out as well, but that wasn't known. But there was I think he was Polish, scientist, mathematician, astronomer, who worked out that actually the sun is at the center of the universe, or the center of our, is the thing that we all revolve around. And it takes that shift, doesn't it, from where we think that, "Oh, God isn't a good God, God isn't a loving God, and he allows suffering, and if I was God, I would do things differently," to a place where we realize how good God is, and how sinful and rebellious we are. And it's that shift, isn't it, where we go, we're not in the center of things, God is in the center of things. And so there is, there's suffering in the world, but it's the result of man's rebellion against God. And it doesn't just impact on us. When people go, "Oh, I'm sinning," when they're living a lifestyle that is against God's word, is in direct rebellion to God, and they go, "Well, it's just me, it doesn't affect anyone, it doesn't hurt anyone." And actually our sin does. Our sin isn't confined to us. We sin as human beings, and our sin affects one another. I mean, you've all grown up in families probably, and if you have a brother or a sister who does something bad, or you're the one doing something bad, and you get told off, or you get excluded from something fun that the family are doing, you can't say that what that person did doesn't affect everybody else. Clearly it creates, an atmosphere, it ruins an occasion, someone is missing. So how we live does affect everyone else. And So our sin from our forefathers, our own sin, the whole of human sin has had an impact and caused this world to become fractured. Obviously, we're living under a curse because of our rebellion from God. And so human suffering is very much inevitable. You know, I know only two people initially raised their hands, but we've all suffered for different reasons. But one of the big reasons we suffer is because of our fallen world, the way we relate to one another, the very fact that you have people who are slaves, who are ruled over by another human being, when God's intention was never for it to be like that. So, but the Bible's an honest book. It talks about everything, doesn't it? Stuff that we might not feel comfortable talking about, the Bible talks about it and shows us how to live. So, it says in verse 21, "For God called you to do good, even if it means suffering, just as Christ suffered for you. He is your example, and you must follow in his steps. He never sinned, nor ever deceived anyone. He did not retaliate when he was insulted, nor threaten revenge when he suffered. He left his case in the hands of God, who always judges fairly. He personally carried our sins in his body on the cross, so that we can be dead to sin." Dead to sin, you know, a dead body doesn't respond. You could try and talk all day, it doesn't respond to it to you. You could bring it a wonderful, tasty cake or some sort of amazing steak. It isn't going to be interested. And so Jesus died so that we could be dead to sin, so that sin doesn't have a hold over us, that we're not led into sin. You know, the Lord's Prayer says, "Lead us not into temptation." So that actually there might be stuff around us, but we haven't been given those desires to indulge in sin, because the Holy Spirit within us has taken our lives and given us new desires, and we're dead to sin. And so we live for what is right, as it says in verse 24. "By his wounds you are healed. Once you were like sheep who wandered away, but now you have turned to your shepherd, the guardians of your soul." And so, you know, the world, as we saw Paul said, actually being a slave is not the primary concern. The primary concern is how you conduct yourselves in the midst of suffering. You know, the world, a big thing, I guess, in the world is identity politics, isn't it? What group of people do you belong to that have suffered or have been victimized or have been, you know, mistreated? You know, and it's a very divisive ideology. It pits people against each other. It kind of, ranks people. And, you know, the people that need to be highly kind of ranked are those who have suffered the most. And it's a twist the fact here it says, you know, being a slave is not your primary concern, and yet there will be causes and people who say we must free people. You know, obviously, please don't misunderstand my heart, because obviously it's with this sort of thing, it can be, you know, you can say the wrong thing, can't you? And people are often worried about speaking out because if they say something silly, don't they? In this day and age where everything's recorded, I think probably on YouTube. And so we're sometimes afraid to say anything at all in case we say the wrong thing. But, you know, one of the biggest things is that we should get rid of any sort of suffering in the world. And that's right. That's right. That's right. God doesn't want us to inflict suffering on one another. But it seems like the world's focus is to help us live as comfortable a life as possible, to avoid any sort of suffering, to make that our number one goal. But as we saw in Corinthians, that's not our number one goal, and it's actually very much anti-Christ. Because if you think about it, Peter, what was he trying to do? When Jesus was being arrested, what did he try and do? He tried to stop. And when Jesus predicted his own suffering, what did they do? They kind of rebuked Jesus and said, "No, not you, Lord." Peter. He tried to stop the people from arresting Jesus by cutting off their ear. And so to try and avoid suffering is not following the example of Christ. It's actually how you conduct yourself in that suffering. Obviously, God is a God of justice, and the Bible says to speak up for those who cannot speak. And so we are, as Christians, called to bring justice to this world, to, you know, things like ending human trafficking, modern-day slavery. We should do that. We absolutely should, because that's what God calls us to. But this verse is saying that actually, if you find yourself in that situation, and it can be applied to our jobs, can't it? It can be applied to our jobs. I mean, you know, the Bible is a timeless book. You know, what it's saying here thousands of years ago is still relevant today. And we can apply the principle. You know, you've got a boss at work that mistreats you. Is our job to kind of start taking them to court, to kind of get our rights? Do you know what I mean? You know, is that following Jesus' example? No, he says, actually, it's to your credit if you bear, what does it say? It says, for God is pleased with you when you do what you know is right and patiently endure unfair treatment. It doesn't say God is pleased with you when you get treated justly because you have demanded justice. And this is where we are. You know, at the start of Peter, it talked about how we are a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a different kind of people, unique. And this is a chance for us to be holy, to be unique, to be different to the rest of the world, where we, you know, endure suffering for the sake of God. It says, if you suffer for doing good and endure it patiently, God is pleased with you. If you suffer at work and your boss doesn't like you because you're late, don't work hard, and, you know, maybe talk too much or just, you know, talk badly about your boss, then that's not what this is talking about. Don't do that. Be a model employee. But this is talking about when you are just unfairly treated. Maybe because your employer knows you are a Christian, or maybe your colleagues know you're a Christian and so mistreat you. But when you suffer for being a good employee, a hard worker, and then you endure that suffering patiently, says God is pleased with you. And so what we shouldn't do is go down the road of identity politics, where we think, oh, my suffering is worse than that person's suffering, because it pits us against each other, doesn't it? You know, have you ever spoken to someone and, you know, shared with them your suffering that week or that month or that day or whatever, and what you've gone through? And what do they respond with? Oh yeah, my week was even worse. Has anyone ever had that? Is it nice? It's not nice, is it? It's not nice, because it suddenly went, oh, okay. My suffering isn't important. Oh, yours is worse. And it's actually, we're not here to try and win the biggest martyr card or the biggest victim card, because it's divisive, isn't it? It says in Galatians chapter 3, verse 28, if you can get that on the screen, because this is what Jesus does. And if we follow Jesus' example, then this is the end result. Rather than divisiveness and disunity and woe is me, my suffering is greater than yours, and being victims, we're actually followers of Christ. And it says, there is no longer Jew or Gentile, slave or free, male and female, for you are all one in Christ Jesus. And many people would try and pit people against each other, wouldn't they? You know, you kind of, what is it, toxic masculinity and feminism and, you know, basically all these kind of movements that try and just say that we're the most victimized group of people. Now, as Christians, we are to care for those, you know, we care for orphans, widows, to care for people with disabilities, to love one another. You know, racism has no place in the church. Sexism, misogyny, all of that, it doesn't have any place in the church because we're all one in Christ Jesus. And the thing that we do because we are one in Christ Jesus is we bear up under suffering. You know, that's it. I'm not saying that we don't, please hear me, I'm not saying that we don't stand up for justice. You know, I'm not saying put yourself in a dangerous position where you are being abused, where you are being, you know, maybe domestic violence or anything like that. We need to be safe, and we need to, as part of our safeguarding responsibilities, to make sure that people are heard, make sure that people aren't put in or allowed to be in unsafe situations. But we are to model Jesus' example, aren't we? And, you know, if we, some people teach that victims and people that are being oppressed are the kind of good guys, and those oppressors are the bad guys. But we all know that the Bible teaches that we've all sinned. We've all sinned. And so it's a dangerous ideology when we start to say, oh, those that are being oppressed are bad. Those that are being oppressed are good and somehow saints, and those doing the oppressing are bad. We have all sinned. We've all fallen short of the glory of God. But actually, when we come to know Jesus, we're all one. You know, we go from being all sinned to all one in Christ Jesus. That's our new identity. That is the biggest identity. You know, we're not, I am a man. I am half Indian, half British. I'm, you know, bald. I'm this high. I'm married. I have two children. Those aren't my identity. My identity is actually I'm a follower of Jesus, saved by him, by his grace and his mercy. And when suffering comes, we respond to it in the way that Peter tells us to here. We endure it patiently. And God often uses suffering to sanctify us, doesn't he? The Holy Spirit will sanctify us, but often he'll do it through our suffering. You know, we I don't know about you, but it's often the suffering, the hardest parts of our lives, the hardest times in our lives, where God really does work on our hearts. It might not be an easy time, it might be a really painful time, but often it's those times that we are maybe feel closest to God, if there's such a thing. You know, God is always around. But when we, you know, it gets, the Bible says in Psalm, I don't know the actual Psalm, but it says that God is close to the brokenhearted. And so if unjust suffering leaves us brokenhearted, we can entrust ourselves to God. This is a common theme in 1 Peter. I'll finish in a few minutes. But it says, where does it say it? In the later bit of, there you go, verse 14 of chapter 4. Actually, can we go verse 12 of chapter 4? It says, "Dear friends, don't be surprised at the fiery trials you are going through as if something strange were happening to you. Instead, be very glad, for these trials make you partners with Christ in his suffering, so that you will have the wonderful joy of seeing his glory when it is revealed to all the world. So be happy when you are insulted for being a Christian, for then the glorious Spirit of God rests upon you. If you suffer, however, it must not be for murder, stealing, making trouble, or prying into other people's affairs, but it is no shame to suffer for being a Christian. Praise God for the privilege of being called by his name. For the time has come for judgment, and it must begin with God's household. And if judgment begins with us, what terrible fate awaits those who have never obeyed God's good news? And also, if the righteous are barely saved, what will happen to godless sinners? So if you are suffering in a manner that pleases God, keep on doing what is right and trust your lives to the God who created you, for he will never fail you." And so that's where I want to leave things, is that actually when we suffer for doing good, God's right there by our side because he knows. He was a man of suffering. And I know I've said I'd leave it there, but I can't help myself sometimes. If we can just go to Isaiah 53, it's the suffering servant. You know, it's not that, I mean, Jesus was prophesied about, wasn't he, thousands, hundreds of years ago. And Isaiah said this. It says, well, just before 53, it says, in the end of 52, it says, "See, my servant will prosper," in verse 13 of 52. "He will be highly exalted. But many were amazed when they saw him. His face was so disfigured, he seemed hardly human. And from his appearance, one would scarcely know he was a man. And he will startle many nations. Kings will stand speechless in his presence. For they will see what they had not been told. They will understand what they had not heard about." Chapter 53. "Who has believed our message? To whom has the Lord revealed his powerful arm? My servant grew up in the Lord's presence like a tender green shoot, like a root in dry ground. There was nothing beautiful or majestic about his appearance, nothing to attract us to him. He was despised and rejected, a man of sorrows, acquainted with deepest grief." So if you're going through grief, deepest grief, Jesus knows. Well, he was well acquainted with it. "We turned our backs on him and looked the other way. He was despised, and we did not care. Yet it was our weakness he carried. It was our sorrows that weighed him down. And we thought his troubles were a punishment from God." You know, that's how we sometimes think wrongly, don't we? When we see people suffering, religious people can often say, oh, it must be a punishment from God. A punishment for his own sins. Can you imagine? "But he was pierced for our rebellion, crushed for our sins. He was beaten so we could be whole. He was whipped so we could be healed. All of us, like sheep, have strayed away. We have left God's paths to follow our own. Yet the Lord laid on him the sins of us all. He was oppressed and treated harshly, yet he never said a word. He was led like a lamb to the slaughter. And as a sheep is silent before the shearers, he did not open his mouth. Unjustly condemned, he was led away. No one cared that he died without descendants, that his life was cut short in midstream. But he was struck down for the rebellion of my people. He had done no wrong. He had never deceived anyone. But he was buried like a criminal. He was put in a rich man's grave. But it was the Lord's good plan to crush him and cause him grief. Yet, when his life is made an offering for sin, he will have many descendants. He will enjoy a long life, and the Lord's good plan will prosper in his hands. When he sees all that is accomplished by his anguish, he will be satisfied. And because of his experience, my righteous servant will make it possible for many to be counted righteous, for he will bear all their sins. I will give him the honors of a victorious soldier because he exposed himself to death. He was counted among the rebels. He bore the sins of many and interceded for rebels." And he intercedes today for us. And he opened a way, it says, for many to be counted righteous. And today we are counted righteous because of what Jesus did for us. And that is the good news of God. And I'm going to leave it there.